Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Liverpool Connection podcast. I'm your host, Daz. I've got Steve, my co-host, with me. And today, all the way from Liverpool, we've got Marc Kenny, a musician and a radio host, right? If I'm correct.
Correct, yes.
With your indie hours.
Yeah. Hello, gents. How are we doing?
Good.
Yeah, cheers, yeah. Great. How are you?
How are we feeling after number 19?
Still drinking.
Yes, correct. I'm on what I've got at the moment, a vodka orange. So a bit of sunny day.
Well, like me and Mark were just speaking, Steve, before he can go down the pub now, you know.
Yeah, I saw that they just recently reopened it, and it's like everybody just got to legal age of drinking. It's and it's like their first day back to drinking ever. So it's great.
Yeah, it's kind of like that. I mean, the pubs opened last weekend. I didn't go last weekend because it was going to be a free for all, you know, full of idiots. As you say, once a year drinkers. So we steered clear of doing that. This week, it's a lot better. Kind of people have been a lot more responsible, respecting all the social distancing and all stuff like that. So it was good. I went, my friend's in a band, and he played outside. So we went and sat in the beer garden. We had glorious weather today, which is quite unusual for these parts of the world. So we had nice sun. So we went and watched them in the beer garden. Great.
Yeah, that's awesome. We had Paul Tremarco from the Arkles a couple weeks ago, and you know, he didn't even know what to do with himself. He hasn't been able to go to the pub and so I know that he was very excited for even to just get back to a little bit of normalcy, to have some people in there and start slinging some pints again.
Yeah, oh, he's ace Paul. Absolutely, yeah. Love Paul. I've known Paul for many, many years now, and I took me lad, actually. Remember the Shrewsbury game?
Yeah.
Earlier this season. And we basically fielded the kids. But I took my five-year-old lad for his birthday present. He turned five in February. So I took him to his first Anfield game. And we went and seen Paul in the Arkles. And Paul made such a fuss of him. Gave him all these kind of badges. He had the big Jurgen Klopp cutout. We got the photo in front of that. Oh, lovely fella, Paul.
Yeah, have you got his Crimbo CD?
Paul CD?
Yeah, here we go.
Really? Yeah. I didn't know about that.
Yeah. Steve, you should cover it.
He's got two CDs, right? We found That's out right. that he actually has two CDs out.
Really?
I have a copy of the Crimbo CD, and so I play it every year. We put the tree out. We play that CD, and then the kids look at me and shake their head and say, okay, let's play some traditional music now.
So I'm assuming it's an Arkle CD and not a Paul Tremarco CD.
No, it's a Paul Tremarco CD.
I'll get lost.
Yeah. I'll post a picture of it on our website so everybody can see it.
Send me the Spotify link as well. I want to listen to that.
Hey, you might have a new set come next week.
Yeah, you never know.
Rainbow in July hits. Oh, man. So, Mark, tell us a little bit about yourself. You know, your love affair with Liverpool Football Club. When did that start?
Right, okay. Quite a romantic story, actually.
Cue music.
Yeah, just like post production here, just put some nice strings and stuff like that. Birds tweeting in the background. I moved to Australia as a kid. We originally planned as a family to emigrate to Australia. So I moved to Australia when I was three-ish. I can't actually remember. I think it was three. And while we're out there, sadly, my granddad, dad, my mum's father, my granddad George, he died. So my mum had a massively difficult time like dealing with everything out there, you know, losing your dad and the other side of the world. And she became massively homesick, and it kind of passed through the family as well. Not me, because obviously I was only five at the time. and we said that we were coming back home anyway. My mum and dad and my older brother and sister, they'd all discussed it, and then, like, you know, a family decision, we're going to move back. So I was living in Perth at the time, and I was following Aussie rules. Even as a small kid, I was massively into my sport, and I supported Perth Eagles. And as a memento, I wanted to bring back a Perth Eagles shirt. And even now, it's something that's always stuck in my head. And my dad said, son, you will not need that. When we go home, we have the best team in the world in Liverpool. And I took his word for it, and I'm so glad I did. So I've been massive red since the age of five. That was my first memory, and it stuck with me through all my life, and how right he was.
What years were these?
What year, right? Okay, so I'm 38 now, so born 81, trying to work it out. So it must have been old, 86, 87. So we're in our prime then. You know, we literally, we'd won three European Cups in, what was it, 5 years? I can't remember the exact figures. So we were proper kings of Europe. Boston, the domestic league, we had the greatest players. I mean, you know, arguably, I know that the boys right now are incredible, but I think they're always going to have to do something extra to live up to the teams that we had of the 80s, because they were absolutely phenomenal. I got introduced as a fan, like when we were in our prime of the 80s, basically.
You know, it's interesting that, because it's been so long since we've won the title, that, you know, you can't, there's such a big separation of the skill levels of that era, and then the skill levels of now, and the training methods, and obviously the foreign players that are in the league now. So it's kind of almost a blessing that it's been so long, so you can't, like, directly compare those two teams.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely. Completely agree. You know, everyone's talking about Virgil van Dijk, and the biggest and natural comparison is Hansen. And you can't compare them. You know, I think, you know, it's the same as all the greatest strikers. You always get compared to Pelé. Completely different era, different game, different skill set, a different football. You know, they different boots, different playing surface, you know, different supply. You know, you the players around you now are far better. But also the players that you're playing against are far better as well. So you can't put things in the same bracket. But yeah, it's crazy. I think the modern day footballer, you're an athlete now. You've got to be on top of your game of whatever you're doing, and that's your health, your fitness, your nutrition, technicality. It's a different game now.
Yeah, it's funny when we bring the legends over to our supporters club, and they'll talk about, like, for instance, Stevie Nicol talk about what he ate during, you know, the break at halftime, or, you know, lighting up a cigarette after the game, you know, immediately. And so it's funny to me that the differences in just the whole overall atmosphere of the player and the training techniques since back in the 80s and then up to now, where this team that we have now seems like they like to put on the ale. We know that Robbo likes the ale, so but they're not eating junk food, it doesn't seem like.
No, I'd love to go for a pint with Robbo, though. He looks good. Fun, doesn't he?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he's a cheeky Scot, but aren't they all?
he loves the banter as well. You can just see the chemistry in this team right now is just, it's second to none. Superb. You can just see it right through the whole squad. And I think it's down to Jürgen's recruitment as well. You know, we only know what we're kind of getting fed through the media and stuff, but it seems to be that Jürgen doesn't just pick the technical player. He picks the all-round player. You know, you've got to be technical, you've got to be fit, you've got to be focused. you've got to have the right family support, and you've also got to fit in with the squad now. Mm-hmm. So you're not going to bring in, you know, for example, like Paul Pogba, for example, there's no denying how good that lad is at football. Absolutely no denying. But you bring him into the Liverpool squad, is he going to fit in? Probably not. Mm-hmm. So there's lots of players that you would pinpoint and say, he'd be brilliant to Liverpool. You know, we need a creative midfielder, for example, or we need some backup striker, or we need a backup keeper. You know, there's lots of points. As good as Liverpool are now, you know, we're not the finished product, and that's what's frightening, because we do need backup, and we do need, you know, more quality brought into this already incredible squad. But Jürgen's not just bringing in people just because they've got a football. Mm-hmm. He's bringing in people that are going to fit in and gel in the squad and help the squad grow, rather than one player shine.
I think that was epitomized by when he let Sako go, that if you're not part of the teamwork and the attitude of the team, then you're not going to be there very long.
Well, 100%. Sako was on the magic.
Yeah, that too.
He also had two left feet as well, so that didn't help.
Yeah. poor bastard actually scored today, and then he ruled it out for handball. Thought that was
great. Oh, really? Yeah. Oh, I didn't see that.
Yeah, brilliant. For Palace.
Brilliant.
So, how was your first like Anfield experience?
My first Anfield experience. I've never actually thought about it. I think it was Luton Town. I think.
Away or home?
No, home. Yeah. Well, Anfield. Yeah, first Anfield experience.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I think it was against Luton. I think we won. I think it was 2-0 or 2-1. I don't know. I have to have a look in the old record books, but I remember them playing in orange. That's all I remember. Again, if I'm right. And I remember we had to park a million miles away. I must have been about 9 or 10, I think. And all I remember, looking back on now, knowing that the setup around Anfield Stadium, it must have been, what's the road that runs from the Arkles? Can't remember the avenue. Anyway, I park there every day. There's a car park on there. But it was a dual carriageway. And I remember walking up and just seeing Anfield kind of ahead in the distance and just being so excited for it. And probably as a kid, probably didn't pay that much attention to the actual game. But I just remember the whole experience and excitement. And again, going back to what my dad said, you know, this is the best team in the world and they're from Liverpool, which is where we live. So I lived in Norris Green at the time then. And just remember, just the pure excitement of it, buying badges, picking up a scarf. I've still got the scarf, by the way, which I passed on to my lad now. And it's not a full-size scarf. And I always thought scarves were that big. It's like a three-quarter length scarf. It's not a full scarf that we have now. And yeah, I've still got it. It's all bobbly and worn now, but my lad's got that now.
You know, I know Daring will agree that we can't, like, I have a son and daughter, and I can't wait to take them to Anfield and experience that same type of atmosphere that when you were a kid. I know when Daring was a kid that his dad took him to the games, and I know that he's looking forward to taking his daughters over there one day. So it's just a magical experience. And it's always, that's why Daring always likes to ask that question, because it, when somebody talks about their first Anfield experience, it kind of brings us all back to it. And it just kind of get that tingly feeling all over again. And like, man, and because we're over here, we want to go back so badly, you know?
Oh, definitely. Well, I can actually kind of bring that in now, because I took my lad to his first game in February.
Oh, nice.
Against Shrewsbury. And because all the tickets and everything were reduced, we paid a little bit extra. We went in one of the suites, and we had Steve McMahon in the suite. So Steve McMahon came over. He'd obviously been tipped off that it was my lad Seb's birthday. And he came over and made such a big fuss about him, and brought over this like little gift bag. And he was chatting to him, doing a high five, and you know, he was getting him involved in the whole thing. And when we went out for the kickoff, I actually filmed him coming up the steps. And when he actually walked up the steps and he's seen the stadium, his face just lights up and he's just like, and it's just magical to see, because it's something that when we went to our first game, or whenever we go to the first game a long time ago, no one had the ability to film and capture the moment. Mm-hmm. But to see that now and to watch it back, I can't wait to show him when he's older and just say, this is your first experience, by the way. This is what you thought. You know, and I'm hoping it'll all come flooding back to him.
Mm-hmm. No, I mean, that's great. You know, that's what you want to do, and especially, like, you know, your son or daughter to actually take them to a match and show them, you know, why you support them, why you've got that little, you know, childish grin on your face is just great. You know,
yeah.
My only problem is putting four youngsters on a plane. I don't think anybody that sits next to me, they're screwed.
I don't envy that.
Well, I don't envy paying for it either.
Yes. Yeah. All of the above.
Yeah. Well, I actually was coming home in May, you know, until all this pandemic crap started. Yeah. I had tickets for Hotel Tia, you know, for the last match of the season and all that, getting ready for the parade. And then, you know, this COVID crap happened. So that put a damper on things. But, you know, as soon as everything kind of calms down and over here in the UK, you know, I'll be on that first flight, you know, for the parade. So hopefully whenever it happens, I'll be on the plane by myself, though, not with the kids or the missus. Yeah, I'm going for a lost week.
No, we'll I think it'll be a lost year, won't it, when we start celebrating? I don't think anyone's gonna, you know, we've all been like socially distancing, celebrating, if that's a correct phrase. Yeah. You know, we've all been celebrating on our own, but like connecting, like for example, like on a Zoom call, mm-hmm. or, you know, celebrating with your family and your immediate friends. But the second that we are allowed to party as a collective group of LFC fans, it's going to go mental for a long time.
It will be.
So we're just looking forward to, you know, it's sad as well about, you know, Henderson getting injured. You know, it looks like he's going to lift the cup anyway.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how it's going to play out, but it looks like that is going to happen. You know, yet no, Jürgen saying he's going to lift it. No one else is going to lift it from what we can gather. But like the homecoming celebration and the parade and all stuff like that, I don't know when that's going to happen, but it's going to be incredible when it does, though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Evertonians going to lock themselves in the house for like weeks.
Oh, yeah.
They're going to board up the windows.
Yeah. Lock up everybody.
Yeah.
Anyone associated with an Evertonian, you need to run and hide.
Yeah. I haven't spoken to my cousins for like 6 months. I've got two that are Evertonians as well. Yeah, they just have a different view on life.
Yeah, full of lemons.
Yeah. So, go on, Steve.
Okay. I know, obviously, we want to ask you about how you got involved with, you know, making songs for Liverpool Football Club, but can you take us back on how you really got into music initially?
I don't know, you know. It sounds very cliche, being from Liverpool, but the Beatles, I guess. I've been brought up on the Beatles. My dad is a massive. My dad was a merchant seaman, so he was on the passenger liners that went back to and fro New York, and my dad was massively into Chuck Berry, and then the Beatles come along, and the Beatles basically took Chuck Berry's music and developed it into what it was. And going back to and fro New York, so my dad was massively into the Beatles, Hank Williams, Chuck Berry. So he had a kind of rock and roll and country background. My mum loved Sam Cooke, and Patsy Cline. So I've always grown up around music, just since a young lad, you know, that I've always had, you know, probably the first song that I knew was Hank Williams' Hey Good Looking, Where You Got Cooking, yeah. You know, and Patsy Cline, Crazy, and, you know, all the other stuff that goes with that. So I've always been around music. I've always had an interest, and it's all I kind of ever knew. And when I was in primary school, I took an interest in, well, we're learning keyboard actually. So you play the melody with one hand and then you play the chords with the other. And your keyboard, I think it was a Yamaha or a Bontempi or whatever it was at the time, that would immediately start playing the background music. So you could kind of play along with whatever chords you were playing. And I really excelled at that. And to a point that within a couple of months, I'd been pushed forward to learning piano with both hands. So that I was like 8 or 9 at the time. So I was really young. And then Oasis came out and they were basically the new Beatles. You know, they basically robbed loads of Beatles melodies, ideas, all the harmonies. And because I'd grown up listening to the Beatles, I shown a massive interest in that, and I wanted to play guitar. So I self-taught myself. I self-taught guitar, transferring what I knew about piano onto the guitar. So I was like, well, if that note and that note and that note makes that chord on your guitar, that means that. And I kind of went from there, really. So that's kind of my introduction to music. And then, it's all been self-taught, really. Never really had any lessons.
So is that your main thing is the music now, you know?
Oh yeah. Oh, it's all on them. It's all like I actually wanted to be an architect because I was really good at maths and as good at art and design technology. So the idea, my career path was going to be an architect, believe it or not. And I went to college, done my A-levels, got my A-levels. But halfway through that, I realized that my passion was really music. So I got my A-levels and then I went and done a foundation course in music after that. And halfway through that, I started gigging, started attending open mic scenes and all stuff like that. And it kind of led from there. It was kind of, I guess it's always been in me, but I was trying to get like a proper job. You know, I was aiming to be an architect because I'd have a secure job for life kind of thing. And music took over, I guess.
Yeah, so I think, you know, at the end of the day, you just got to make yourself happy, you know, like, I know for me, I wanted to actually do historic preservation, be an archaeologist and everything. But my passion was cooking. And, you know, I'm a chef to this day.
Well, there you go. Yeah.
You know, I just went that way. I just remember, you know, my nan, you know, watching her cook. And then just, I went to, did some school and then just went, it's not for me. You know, like, I want to come home happy, you know, not yeah. Be like, oh man, I got to hit the books and everything and, you know, do that. But that, I mean, yeah, you got to make yourself happy these days.
But, no, that's it. I think, you know, the kind of go back to what I was saying, like I was planning on being an architect, but I was planning on being an architect. I mean, I love art. I loved numbers. I don't love numbers anymore. But at the time, I've always been really good at maths. So it was kind of like combining the two. But I was more combining it for a career prospect and looking for your future. And as a 15, 16-year-old kid, you know, to ask someone to make a career choice like that, you can't do that because you don't know what you're going to be. Mm. But I think the passion for music always... it was always going to win, if you like.
You know, a few weeks ago, we had another guest on our show, Joel Walmsley. He's a Scouser. He lives in San Antonio now, and he's a musician as well. And he told us stories about just playing a lot of different gigs around Liverpool and even at the Cavern. So do you have similar experiences to that? Were you able to parlay your musical stuff into playing around the Liverpool city?
Yeah, Well, I played the Cavern more times than the Beatles.
Nice.
So nice. I've lost count. I must have played it about 500 times. I've been one of the resident artists there for nearly 10 years now.
Nice.
And sometimes it's like 2-3 gigs a week. So I've never actually counted them up. But, you know, potentially some years there's been 150 gigs a year. So it might be more like 1,000, I don't know. But I played there lots and lots of times.
What would you classify your genre of music then when you're playing, say, at the Cavern?
It's different really, because I've got a Beatles tribute band as well. So okay. We've got a Beatles tribute band, Paid Back Writers. So the genre there is Beatles.
Right, of course.
if that's a genre. but other than that, I'd probably say rock and pop. So it's kind of popular, stroke, rock. Obviously, I do a lot of stuff, acoustic and vocals. So kind of singer-songwriter. But I'd say predominantly like rock pop.
So what brought you when you made this? I know you didn't make the song, but it's off the Terraces, the Bobby song, Si Señor.
Oh, Si Señor, yeah.
With the Ragamuffins, how did that come about?
It's a strange one actually, and it's kind of like it's one of them, you know, a weird set of circumstances, kind of. Led us to be there, but I actually got introduced to David from the Ragamuffins, and it was from Baz Todd. He's a local radio presenter. I think he was on Juice FM. It's not going anymore, but he went on to work for some other radio stations, but he got brought in as a host for anyone that's been to Anfield will understand what I'm talking about, but you've got outdoor entertainment stages outside Anfield. So before the game, about 3 hours before, there's a couple of outdoor stages and they've got live bands playing there. They do like keep you up competitions. They do giveaways. They have personalities on there. So for example, like sometimes like Jason McAteer or Phil Thompson or some of the other lads get up on the stage and they do a little Q&A. And I just happened to be there at this time. And Baz Todd introduced me to David from the Ragamuffins. And he's like, oh, Dave, Mark, meet Mark. You know, Mark does a similar thing. Does the pre-match entertainment. Mark's put out a couple of songs. And yeah, just the whole Liverpool connection, basically. And we got chatting. And I think it was the following day or the day... maybe 2 days later, and he sent me over this, it's like a voice note, basically, it was on WhatsApp, and he said, oh, well, I've been working on this, and he sent me over a demo for Si Señor, and I rang him back about 5 minutes later. I was like, mate, this is massive. I said, do you realise what you're doing here? He went, yeah, it's good. David sounds a little bit mank, but he's from Lancashire. He's not actually from Manchester. He's from Lancashire. And he's like, oh, that sounds good. I went, no, mate. I said, this is massive. I said, you have no idea what you've done here. I said, we need to do this and record it and get it out there. I said, let's get him. When are you free? So we got in the next week and we recorded it. And we had a chat. And we were like, oh, we need to do this for charity. We both, at the time, the only charity that we were going to do it for was Fan Support and Food Banks. And we were both on the same page about it. So we got in, recorded the song. Red Men TV got involved with the video. So they've done all the video and helped out with all the promo and stuff for it. And the song was out about 2 weeks later. It was literally just like a whirlwind thing, how it happened. But it started from David sending me over this demo. And I was just blown away by it. I was like, that's class. Like that needs to be out there so people can hear it and get involved. And then I think the pinnacle of it, well, one of the pinnacles, sorry, was seen as in Madrid. Mm-hmm. And
Bobby running around the pitch, jumping around, and all the players clapping. And Si Senor was getting played in the stadium, and we were like, that's out of this world. You know, it's like that. That's kind of what you dream of. I mean, the idea that the players are on the pitch, just won a European Cup, and they're on the pitch singing along with your song. It's crazy.
Well, I mean, it's crazier when you see scenes in the locker room and they're singing the Van Dijk song, and then they're singing Firmino song, and it goes, and it's just like they get it, right? They get it that the fans are in it too.
No, they know it, and that's why I was saying, like, one of the pinnacles. We got sent another video, and it was Bobby's wife, and she's dancing around the living room, singing Si Senor, and she's got the track playing in the background, and you're like, you know, it's a fan chant, but then we actually put it down on record, so to speak, and we put down the arrangement, and like, they're playing it on Spotify or Apple or whatever, doing it, and, you know, the idea that his wife loves the song so much that she's getting videoed singing it, just it's so special. Crazy.
I don't like this one. It doesn't work.
Steve, you all right?
Yeah. I think he's been given a grapefruit juice. Yeah. What was it?
It's one of those beers that has a smoke flavor to it.
And like a salmon smoke.
Yeah, it was like liquid smoke. They put liquid smoke on top, and
Steve likes his fancy beers.
Oh, are you into your IPAs?
Yeah, all the time. So.
No, I like IPAs. Yeah, IPAs are good.
One or two, but yeah, they just kind of bog me down a bit.
they are rocket fuel. I think that's why I like them. You only have to drink two.
That's right.
Yeah, well, we've got a mate. He only needs to drink half.
Who's that? Are you going to drop him in it? Who's that?
Yeah, that's our mate called Little Glenn.
Little Glenn?
Yeah, he's about 5'6", and it doesn't take much.
Yeah, I'm only 5'7".
Oh, yeah.
Well, 5'7" and a half.
Oh, wow. You got to get the half in there, though.
Oh, yeah, the half counts. So I've been told.
Yeah. So how did you, I mean, besides the Firmino song, I read that you did a Trent song as well recently?
Yeah, I've just done a Trent Alexander-Arnold song, and it's like, you know, to be honest, not expecting it to get, I'm not expecting a transition onto the terrace. You know, at the end of the day, the fans... we pick it up organically. You know, it could be on an away day, it could be on a coach, it could be in the pub, and someone comes up with something and someone starts singing it. And especially nowadays, you know, someone films it, goes in the internet, goes viral. So it can come from nowhere. So the idea of the Trent song, just about putting something out there that, you know, to kind of acknowledge what a player he is. And there was no real song. I know we sing the Scouser in our team. But we sing that about any Scousers in our team. So it felt like he needed something just for him. And that's kind of what come about, really. You know, it wasn't... not expecting it to be sung on the cop, but it was just kind of like a nod to him, just to say, you know, what a player he is, really.
You want to sing it now or no?
I can go and get a guitar if you want.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah, go ahead.
Do you want
to? Yeah, of course.
Right, okay, like, you two chat amongst yourselves for a minute or so.
We'll talk about Paul's CD.
Go on then. Give him a plug, he might get a download or two. Let me go and get a guitar. Hang on.
All right, cheers.
Yeah, you got to have Mark do a song if he's going to be on the podcast.
Yeah,
hey, you know, he mentioned Liverpool Connection. That's a great name for a podcast, by the way.
It is. I heard that as well, and I was like, oh, wow. Yeah, well, we beat him to it, so.
That's right. Nah, 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 nah.
Oh, so, wow. See, look, we get a free concert. You never know what's going to happen on this podcast. Right. Maybe you're just flying off the cuff here.
Maybe we'll get some fireworks. Maybe he'll piss off his neighbors again.
That was a funny story.
Oh, man, yeah.
I hear
twanging.
Some Patsy Cline coming up for all our listeners.
See, now we get a personal concert. What song are you asking for?
He can sing Patsy Cline to me. That's fine.
Yeah.
Or Hank Williams. He can sing that.
All googly-eyed.
That's right.
he can sing whatever he wants. I'm sure he's going to do the Trent song. I mean, so got to.
Here he comes.
Steve, you got your maracas?
Yes, but it's also a bottle opener, so I'll leave it. I don't have any.
Yeah, I've got the rice shaker.
Go on, I'm back. I was pulled CD.
It was great.
Oh, man, brilliant.
All right.
Next time you go into the Arcos, you got to tell them that you heard about a CD, okay?
I will do. I'll wind them up about that. So, we've not done any kind of sound check, so I don't know if it's going to blare down the mic. Can you guys tell if it's distorting or?
Yeah, you'll see our facial expressions.
Yeah, I'll sit back off the mic a little bit. We should be all right. This is the track I'll play. I'll play a verse and a chorus just to give you the kind of idea of it. So this one's out now, actually. If you go on Spotify, Apple, all the usual places, it's on there. So Trent Alexander Arnold. Trent Alexander-Arnold, corner taken quickly.
He's everywhere on the right side. He comes up from the back. He knocks it into the center. When we're on the attack, this lad, he's from West Derby. He's won the Champions League. He knocked out a sleeping Barcelona on the way to Madrid. Trent Alexander-Arnold scouts a red hot team. Trent Alexander-Arnold corner taken quickly. Riggy.
Here you go.
Yeah, woo.
Yeah, that's it. That's kind of it. It's obviously taken from the Barcelona night.
Yeah. We'll make sure that our ministers of song at our supporters club learn that and get it going at our next time we all congregate at the pub. Yeah. So we have a couple of them.
Yeah.
They're excellent. Justin and Matthew are always getting the crowds going with the chants and the song. So it's.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Thank you.
No, that was great. That was much, much better than Paul. I mean, just a bit. I mean,
only a bit better.
Yeah.
That's good.
I haven't even heard his CD. It's just Steve's been telling me, and then Paul, like, you know, told me, and I was like, wow, yeah, I can only imagine how that CD sounds.
Hey, Mark, so I know that you're doing the KopConnect in Las Vegas this next year. Hopefully it happens, right?
Yes. So the background of that, we've done a Liverpool supporters convention last year, the first one that's ever happened, set in Las Vegas. So we've done that last year, and it coincided with the Champions League final.
It
was crazy because we went off the back of Glasgow Celtic. They've been doing a supporters convention for nearly 25 years in Las Vegas, and one of the KopConnect guys, like one of the founders, Alex Malone, he writes for This Is Anfield, and he's been there. I think he's been to three or four of them now. And every time he's gone, he's like, why aren't Liverpool doing it? Why aren't Liverpool doing it? And 2 years ago, he was like, I want to do this. So we started reaching out and building the team. I got asked to get involved in it from the music side of it. And now one of the partners in it, there's three of us involved. There's myself, Alex Malone, and a lad called Danny Greenwood. And both of them are actually in Canada now. Alex Malone, he did live in California at the time, but he's now up in Vancouver Island. And the idea was to put on something that not rival Celtic, because it's not a competition. They've been massively, massively supportive of us, and they've helped us out, and they give us lots of guidelines and guidance of how to put on an event on that scale. And that's what we're doing, yeah. So we had our first one last year, which is incredibly well received. We won the Champions League. We watched it in the official supporters club in Las Vegas, which is McMullen's Irish pub. Yeah. So we watched it there, and there's about 700 of us. And the whole experience. We took out, I flew out with Roy Evans, David Johnson, and Howie Gale. Yeah. So we all went out there, and I think the difference about KopConnect, so a lot of things, like if you go to a signing or something like that, you go and see the player, you shake the hands, they sign your shirt, yeah, or they sign a photo, or they do that, and they go, oh yeah, that's $12, that's $15, whatever. This is different. You're kind of on holiday with the players for the week, and you go down to the bar, the pool, sorry, of a day. The players are there, the Sass and the Sun loungers, they're having a beer, they're getting... The players probably loved it more than we did, the ex-players, sorry, because it was such a relaxing environment, and there's everyone just absolutely... We had the ball, it was great. Yeah. So we were going to do it again this year until COVID took over. So it's now been pushed back to next year. So we've got Roy Evans, he's one of our ambassadors. So we've got Roy Evans. We've got Brucey Grobbelaar as well. Brucey's coming.
Nice.
Yeah.
Bruce Grobbelaar in Vegas. Who doesn't want to be there with him?
Well, he was here in Austin with us, so we can just imagine.
he was doing handstands at 2 a.m.
Oh, he's a great lad, Bruce.
Out the pub. Yeah, he was well lit.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, he's brilliant. Bruce is all over it. He loves all that.
Yeah.
And we've got David Fairclough as well.
Nice. Yeah.
Nice.
We had David Fairclough.
Super sub. And we've got, I can't disclose it because it's not been confirmed yet, but we've got a couple more.
Liverpool connection.
Yeah, Liverpool connection. I can't disclose them because they aren't confirmed yet, but we're talking about LFC royalty in the same regard as Fairclough, Roy Evans, and Bruce Grobbelaar. They're held in the same regard as them. They are literally LFC royalty. Nice. So we've got another two that we're working on now. Yeah. Which should be announced in next week or two.
That's great when they can all come into the in the same place. You know, our supporters club, we've been very fortunate because we've had Bruce here. We've had David Fairclough. We had John Barnes last year.
So Steven, we're one John of the Nickel.
Oh, Barnes, he's great, isn't he?
Yeah, Stevie Nickel, Alan Kennedy has been here. So we've been able – but to spend a weekend and like you said, that they're just not – coming to speak and sign and leave, that they're actually hanging around.
We had
we had a guest a couple weeks ago, Stacy from Las Vegas, Stacy Wilani.
Stacey, you know her.
She's great. Lovely. Yeah, she is lovely, and you know, she's definitely, she's Miss Las Vegas. She's on the television all the time, so we enjoyed our visit with her, and you know, I had met her in Las Vegas back in January, and that's how, you know, we established our relationship. But yeah, that's excellent. So you're going to have Rob Glover dance while you're singing?
We are, yes.
Good old Rob.
Dance on the tables. But yeah, Rob Glover's a very good friend.
Yeah.
So Rob's getting involved with what's going on as well. So It's all good. Yeah, we're gonna bring some glitz and glamour to Vegas if that's possible.
Yeah. I've seen them dancing, so there's gonna be a lot of glamour and glitz for.
Rob is an incredible dancer. Like,
yes, I know.
It's crazy because to meet him, you know, if you've not met him before, he's so unassuming. But you see him dance, he can really dance.
Yeah, it's funny. We went to Liverpool together, and we went to a club, and that there was dancing, and so everybody's dancing. Then once Rob gets on the floor, everybody just kind of backs off, and it looks like a scene out of a movie, and it's excellent. I love him to death, man. He's funny.
It's either that, or he's got a bad farce on him.
Yeah,
he knows how to clear the dance floor. But yeah. in a good way.
Yeah, no, it's excellent. There's we always talk about how it ends up being a small world that, you know, that you meet people and you travel and you go back and you make these connections that are permanent, you know, they're not temporary. And it's almost like family whenever you go back to Liverpool or you're in the United States or you know, even when you went to Vegas last year for that you meet a lot of great people.
100%, and that's what's crazy about this KopConnect that we're doing as well. It's become a network of Reds across the globe. I mean, it's literally it's becoming what the name is. It's connecting Kopites all over the world, and it's. I think it's something far bigger than we actually anticipated of what we were doing. I think we all had the idea of what we were going to do. Mm-hmm. And the initial idea, you know, as you say, it was to do a convention in America, in Las Vegas rather. And it's grown into a community almost, like an extended LFC family. Mm-hmm. And the people that you're meeting online and the people that are joining us, especially on the Facebook group has gone absolutely mental.
Yeah.
And it's people from all over the world. You know, you're talking about like from Australia, Thailand, all over Europe, obviously the UK, the States, Canada, Brazil. It's literally people all over the globe are all connecting. And what's been really nice as well, particularly people that have been joining the KopConnect Facebook group, when they join, they're sharing some photos and they're sharing a little bit of a story about their background. You know, whether that be their first Anfield experience, for example, or how they got involved in the club, or their travels across the world, or their favourite player, their favourite game. It's mad. People are just sharing stories and it's fascinating to read.
What are the dates?
The dates next year. Right. It is the 3rd to the 7th of June. So it's the week after the Champions League final, because we're going to be in the Champions League final next year.
That's right.
So we've done it the week after.
I was supposed to be at the one last year, and that coincided with the Champions League final, but the wife had different plans for us for that weekend. I sat in a bar by myself in Costa Rica watching the game, but that's okay.
You poor thing in Costa Rica.
I was going to say that there's worse places to be.
one Red fan and one Manc.
Even better. As long if there was a Manc there, it's even better.
The things that you go through, because I'm on the phone there trying to help prepare the pub here for that day, and I'm making sure that the pub owner in Costa Rica is going to get the game, because I had been messaging them for a month prior to that. It's like, you better have the game. There's no other TV around in this whole little town that we're in the mountains, you know. So it was it was quite excellent.
Yeah, that was mental that day when we won it. Like it was like 110 here in Texas, just, and the pub was just shocker, just absolutely rammed. That like sweat was like coming off the ceiling. Yeah,
sounds like the cavern.
It's absolutely, absolutely amazing.
Except the cavern is like only 8 foot tall ceiling, right?
Yeah,
it is. Yeah, well, you're kind of in arches, so you know, if you're taller than me, you've got a duck.
Well, we're the same height, so that's no problem for me.
Talking of the cabin though, I want to ask you about Paul McCartney played there, because I read, you know, your bio, and that's got to be like, you know, your dream gig to go see him in the cabin.
Oh, wow, yeah. I managed, there was only, I can't remember the number, I think it was 120 people. So there was only about 120 tickets released for this gig in the cabin. He played in the cabin in 1999. And I think everyone thought that that was going to be his final ever gig there. And then a couple of years ago, we'd done the carpool karaoke with James Corden, and he returned to Liverpool. And everyone was like, he's going to do the cavern, he's going to do the cavern. And then that went and gone. And we're like, oh, maybe he's not. So then I think it coincided with it, with his tour, or the promo for his tour, rather, and his new album. And he'd done a secret gig in the cavern. And bizarrely enough, I was playing in the cavern the day before his gig was scheduled. So I went into the back office of the cavern. And it, again, anyone who knows the layout of the cavern, you've got the main stage in the front, and then you've got the cavern live lounge in the back. Mm-hmm. And I went into the back room. That's where the office is. So I went to get paid, and I walked into the back room, and it was like the whole of the cabin had been like cleaned out, and it was like a film set. There was all cameras, and we're going, what's going on here? There's something going on here. And I asked all the staff, I asked the management, and they say, oh no, they passed it off. They were saying that they were just doing some filming for something. I'm like, all right, okay. So I got paid, went home, and then rumours started circulating on the internet that Paul McCartney was in town. And we just put two and two together, like, he's playing in the cavern. You know, everyone was being too hush-hush. They weren't giving out any information. It's like, it's got to be that. And then it got announced that he was doing a gig in the cavern. Later that day, it actually came out on the internet. And then they said they're going to be releasing tickets. So I went over with the family. We went over first thing to Liverpool, because we knew they were releasing tickets somewhere. We didn't know where, but we knew that they were releasing tickets. And it got announced, I think it was about 9 a.m. The tickets were at the Echo Arena box office. And we were actually on the Albert Dock at the time. So we nipped over to the Echo Arena, and we were in the queue and got some tickets. And it was the most incredible gig. I don't think it can be topped. I think there was about four people in front of us, but the cavern's only small anyway. So we were literally almost in touching distance of McCartney. And he played all the Beatles ones, all the big hits, some of his new album, and some of the rarities as well, some of the B-side, not the B-side, sorry, but the stuff that wouldn't normally be played in like a typical Paul McCartney set. Like he'd done In Spite of All the Danger, for example, which was the first recording that the Beatles ever done when they were called the Quarrymen. And to be there when he played it, and to be that close to him, just, it was so special.
Oh, man, that will be...
I've got goosebumps talking about it now. Honestly, it's just magical.
Did they allow cameras?
Well, no, they didn't.
Some
people did. It wasn't like a contract or anything, but like when you got the tickets and when you went in there and he said, no filming, no photos, nothing. And he stopped halfway through a song. And he was like, whoa, 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 whoa. No cameras. Put your camera down. You can't. We're all here to enjoy it. He's like, put your phones away. And everyone respected it after that. But before that, you could see, even though everyone had been told not to film it, there was still a couple of people like taking liberties. But once he told everyone to put the phone away, he said, you can watch me on YouTube. You're here now. Enjoy it. You know, I'm here. You don't need to film me. I'm here playing in front of you. And once he, I think that was like the second song in, something like that. So once he'd said that, everyone's phone was firmly in the pocket then.
Yeah, you got to listen to Sir Paul.
You do. He's the boss, isn't he?
So, you're on In Demand Radio, right?
Yes, got a brand new show on there. It's called In the Hours. It's kind of independent and local music. I try and focus a lot on local music. We've got a local legend here in the form of Billy Butler, who has been a massive help to me throughout my career. Any new songs, any new recordings, been on there multiple times as a guest over the years, as have many of the Merseyside artists as well. And it just kind of felt right to give something, give a little bit back. So I've done, it's called Indie Hours, not necessarily indie music, but indie music means independent music. So, you know, anyone that's self-funded on a smaller label, you know, rather than one of the major labels, promoting them, playing their new songs. I do an artist lockdown where we get one of the local artists in who's got a new release. We'll play 4 or 5 tracks from that, have an interview with them. Kind of like this, kind of had like an informal chat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what gave you inspiration? What have you been doing? What are you planning to do? And it's been going really, really well. So excited about that. I've been about 3 months in now, but you know, each week it feels like it's getting better and better and better. So it's going really well.
Well, the music has always been there in Liverpool. You know, obviously the Beatles and everything. But all you have to do now is, like, you know, look at the success of Jamie Webster. You know,
yeah,
he deserves it. You know. Like, not just because of his Liverpool songs, because that's all people really know him, you know, over there especially. They just know him because, you know, he sings at Boss Nights. But, like, the new album, from what I'm hearing, I've heard 2-3 songs. It's just fantastic, you know, and Tee Street Band. I love them, you know.
Well,
so
I went to college with most of them.
Did
so, yeah. Yeah, so when I was telling you before, after my sixth form, I got my A-levels. And whereas most people would take your A-levels and go on to university, I went and done, then it was National Diploma in Rock and Pop. And in my class was Timo. And Lee as well. Well, there's also Nick Ellis as well. So they were actually called the Maybes first.
Mm-hmm.
So they were massive. Like they were like mates with Oasis. They were getting championed by them as to be the next big band to come from Liverpool. And for whatever reason, just never really clicked for them. And then from the Maybes, they then formed the Tee Street Band. And you know they do all like. How do you describe it? It's like 90s-infused Britpop with a bit of disco in it as well.
Mm-hmm.
From the Manchester scene and the Hacienda days and stuff like that. So they've kind of fused guitar and dance. But yeah, they're smashing it. They're doing really, really well.
Yeah, I forgot the name. Who's the lead singer?
Of?
Tee Street.
Timo.
Timo, yeah. He's got the most Scouse haircut.
Oh,
yeah, you know,
yeah, he's
only a Scouser could actually get away with that haircut.
Yeah, he's it's funny as well because like even in college, Timo was a little bit great. Like he's kind of like how do you describe his haircut? It's like it's very Beatles-esque.
Yeah,
but even as a young lad, he's always had great flex as well. So, like, even when, like, we were in college, I mean, how old? He must have been, like, 20, 21-ish, 20, 19, whatever it was. But he had a couple of great flex then. And but he's got such a full head of hair. He's like, you know, it's a proper Beatles barnet, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it reminds me a bit of Tim Burgess. You know how he has his hair as well.
Jonathan Tim Burgess, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, just sound. Yeah, because I actually met saw the band for the first time, actually, when I was home two years ago. I went to the Anfield rap party and they played at uni. And I was like, who's this band? Like, they're just grooving, you know. And then I saw Timo with the air, and my mate nudged me and went, only Scousers could get away with that haircut. So I was like,
they're doing so well, though. And it's kind of like, I think you kind of hit the nail on the head then. You're saying, like, they were grooving along. That's what they do. Mm-hmm. It's kind of, they play, and you immediately start dancing, or you nod your head, or whatever. It's just, you know, they're doing great. And I say, I went to college with them, so I've known them nearly 20 years now. So they're killing it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, I can't wait till, like, the KopConnect. Just so me and Steve can go to Las Vegas. I've never been there, so.
Really?
No, never.
You're not far away. How far is Texas?
Not too far. Yeah, I went to high school there.
Don't want to drive there, though.
How long's the drive there? Eight?
It's 24 hours.
Yeah.
Is that far?
I did that 2 years ago. I went and played in a footy tournament, and I didn't make a decision because I had been sick. So I didn't make a decision until 2 days prior. They said, hey, we're short players. I said, okay, it's too late to buy a plane ticket because it would have been, you know, $2,000. Like, I'll just rent a car, drove there. And, you know, it's nice scenery. You know, and I was saying I lived in Las Vegas during high school. And then went back as an adult. I left Austin, and I was there for 6 months. And I was like, I can't be here. All I was doing was drinking, eating, working, no sleep, and then all the other extracurricular activities I was doing. I was like,
Vegas.
I got to get out of here. This is not good for my health.
Yeah, well, I think that's what's perfect about KopConnect. You know, it's 4 days in Vegas. I think. Mm-hmm. I think four days is enough. I mean, obviously, you know, like, I'll be flying out with the players. I think we're going to be going Tuesday to Tuesday, so we're gonna land in Vegas on the Tuesday. Then we're gonna have some downtime on the Wednesday. No, Bruce Grobbelaar, he'll want to play some golf, so we might be playing golf on the Wednesday, and then Thursday, we're gonna have a Beatles night.
Nice.
In the hotel bar, it's the casino bar of Westgate Resort. So anyone not familiar with Las Vegas, everyone knows that Elvis sang in Las Vegas. Well, it's at this place that we're doing a convention, which is Westgate Resort. It used to be the old Hilton. So on the Thursday, that's kind of like officially the first night. So we're doing like a Beatles night in the casino bar. Then on the Friday, we're doing a meet and greet with the three players that we've got on already, which is Roy Evans, Bruce Grobbelaar, and David Fairclough. There are two more to be added to that. I'd say I can't disclose them because I'll be tempting fate, so it won't go through. Yeah. But they are very, very close to being confirmed, and all the info will be released in the next week or two. So that's on the Friday morning, we're doing the meet and greet. Then we're doing a pool party because that's why we're doing it in Vegas. You got the weather. You got the sunshine, you got the pools, you know, we're all going to have a great time there.
Yeah, nothing like watching all you British people get burnt.
Pasties.
There's some cabanas there as well. There's plenty of shade, but yeah, we're going to look like lobsters on the Friday night. And then on the Saturday, that's the champions night because we are champions. And that will be a little bit more, like your traditional night. We're going to get it's more like a show, if you like, because we're infusing the music as well as the history and the stories of Liverpool. We've got all the graphics on the big screens, got all the lights, the smoke, you know, the whole shebang, basically. And we've got the players on the stage. We've got Ragnhild. From Hotel Tia, she's come over with Live Girls.
Oh, nice!
So, you know, so Live Girls is a big part of what we're doing as well. The female connection of the Liverpool, the fan network. You know, the female f- female football's exploded as well. So it's kind of important that we incorporate, we've got to make the ladies feel welcome as well, you know, because up to now, it's been predominantly a male-led sport, but it's not, it's all inclusive, and the girls are just important as well. So we're doing live girls.
Yeah, we just interviewed an ex-LFC player last week on our podcast. She actually is from my neighborhood, so it was excellent to get a viewpoint and her perspective on LFC on the women's side. And as you're right, you know, we all need to do better on that.
We do. And I think it's something we're all conscious of now as well. You know, the females need to be included because, you know, it has been predominantly male-led for a long time. For, you know, something I've learned over the last few years, that the females love LFC as much as the males. You know, it's not gender bias. If you love Liverpool, you love Liverpool regardless of gender. So, you know, I think that's really important that we're all inclusive of that as well.
And so some of them can drink better than the fellas as well.
They can. Of course they can. They can do everything as well as us does.
Mm-hmm. and more so, actually. Yeah.
Yeah. They can certainly multitask better than the males from what I've found as well. So that's a Saturday. So that's going to be the Champions Night, as we're calling it. So it's going to be big show in one of the ballrooms of Westgate. So we're going to have live music from myself. We've got a few others involved as well, the Whiskey Fiddlers. So we've got some Irish connection in there, especially for the likes of the Virgil van Dijk song and Fields of Anfield Road. It's going to be mega. So that's the Saturday. And then the Sunday, which is kind of our farewell night, called Hello Goodbye. We're doing it at the Supporters Club, McMullen's. So the official supporters club in Las Vegas. We're doing like a farewell night there. And then we're going to carry on the Monday. I'm going to play some golf with the players. So we're going to get out and play a few holes with them.
Yeah,
and
there's good golf courses there in Las Vegas.
For sure. There is. We played one last year and made me laugh, because in the UK or anywhere else around the world, if you hit a ball on the rough, you have to, the grass gets longer. If you hit a ball in the rough in Las Vegas, there's snakes and right. stuff there. Yeah. There's no rough there, just rocks and snakes.
Yeah, you have to... You use your club to find your ball. You don't reach down with your hand to find your ball.
No, you don't. And you also, which I've never come across before, you get I can't remember what it's called now. It's like it's called a rough club. And it's a club that you can play off stones and rocks. Mm-hmm. So you don't wreck all the other clubs.
Right.
They give you, I think it must be like a 7-iron or something like that. I know the players golf and know what I'm on about. But they give you like a 7-iron. And if you look at the bottom of the club, there's all chips, it's scratched. It's, you know, it's basically a crap club that you can hit rocks with and play your ball out of. But to be honest, there's no point. If you hit your ball in the rocks in Las Vegas, you leave it there. Don't bother looking for it.
Well, I think Steve and I will defo be going next year.
We'll be there for sure, yeah.
Oh, definitely. Well, you need to bring some of the Texas guys along with you as well.
Yeah,
don't drive 24 hours to get a flight.
No.
Well, I mean, the drive wouldn't be so bad going there. It's coming back when you're hungover.
Coming back when you're hungover, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, when I drove there, we ended up losing in the semifinals, which would have been the Sunday night because the finals were Monday. So I ended up just leaving. I didn't want to stick around because I was going to be drunk the next morning anyway. So I was like, I'm just leaving. But yeah, the drive back was not as fun as the drive there for sure. So no, we'll be flying out, Daz.
I want those free peanuts.
Well, you guys are guests of honor. When you come, we'll look after you.
Cheers. Yeah, I just want to see Stacey again. She's so much fun, and all the other people from Las Vegas. You know, every time I've been there the last 2 years, and they're just. I'm so glad that they got their official supporters club. You know, started and
the great one on now. Actually, so do you know Roddy there?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So have you seen Roddy's number plate?
No, because right, okay. Games are like early in the morning, and so yeah. I'm barely getting there myself.
So Roddy's number plate is you never walk alone. Like, you never walk alone. 96. That's his number plate, and we got there on the first day, and I was just blown away by it because like our number plates here don't make any sense,
right?
My number plate is DY67UPB or whatever it is. It just letters and numbers. It means nothing. In what I found out, in the States, you can pick your number plate. So
yes.
you can say, I want them letters in that order, and that's what it is. So he's got You Never Walk Alone 96, and I was just blown away by it. Mm-hmm. And Brody came out and went, you can have it. And I went, what? He went, well, in the States, we only need the back one. We don't need the front one. I've got two. You can have it. And I was like, oh, you can't do that. And so anyway, on the last day before we came back last year, we went and played golf. And literally, just as we were saying our goodbyes, Roddy went, I've got something for you. And he ran to his car and he brought the other plate with him. And he went, this is yours. And I was just like, are you for real? I couldn't believe it because it's just so special. Firstly, the numbers and letters mean so much as a Liverpool fan.
Right.
But secondly, as a memento and a gift to bring back from Las Vegas, it was just so special. So I've got the number plates up in my recording studio.
That's brilliant.
Mm-hmm. I need to get a new license plate as well. But you can't even get down the driver's place anymore. So you have to wait till they open up again. So, but wanted to ask you if somebody wants to get a hold of you for any bookings and stuff, you just go to your website, right, Mark?
Oh, anywhere. I mean, you know, now more than ever, you know, certainly anyone that does anything like what I do, Twitter, Facebook. I think there's a way to send a message on YouTube as well now. But my website, which is markkenny.co.uk. But probably the easiest way is probably Facebook or Instagram, Twitter, anything like that. You know, I'm very reachable. There's no problem with that. It's easy enough to get hold of me.
Yeah, I know that prior to everything closing this summer, that quite a few people had reached out to me and said, are you going to go to Las Vegas and we'd like to go. So I know that by next year, everybody's going to be itching to get somewhere to party. And, you know, the last three or four times that Liverpool has played in the United States, we've traveled with 60 plus people to the various cities. So I know we'll bring a contingent to Vegas for sure.
Superb. Well, we actually, the tickets are going to be going on sale this week as well for KopConnect. So anyone that wants to come and do the biggest LFC party that Las Vegas has ever seen, see, I'm doing a bit of promo there. All you got to do, you can find us, join our Facebook group. We've got a Facebook page and a Facebook group. So if you just put in KopConnect, all one word or split up, you know, however you type it, join our Facebook group. Or the website is copconnect.com. So the tickets are going to be going on sale this week. Ridiculously priced, $120.
Oh, so wow. That's for the four days.
That's for the 4 days, but it gets better because Westgate basically have given us an absolutely incredible deal. Some of the hotel nights, it's $55 a night. And that's including, by the way, your resort fee, so the waiver and the resort fee, and it's including your Wi-Fi as well. So the Wi-Fi itself is worth about $40. You've been to Vegas. And Stephen, you've said you've been to Vegas before.
Yeah, I lived there, so I know. Yeah.
Oh, you lived there? Sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you in the resorts, you pay like $40 for your Wi-Fi alone. So the deal that Westgate have given for the room is absolutely incredible. Mm-hmm. But you can only get that through our website. So if you try and book on the Westgate website, you'll get charged like $99 a night, and you'll get your resort fees and you get charged for all that. If you go through our website, KopConnect.com, you get all our deals that we've struck up with them.
Ah, brilliant. Yeah. And even like the flight there is not too much either, I don't think.
No, well, they have good specials.
Yeah, well, even from the UK, if you know that you're going in advance, I mean, you know, it's like, you know, Stephen, you were talking about trying to get to from Texas to Las Vegas, and it was $2,000 trying to book it a couple of days before. It's the same from anywhere, you know.
Yeah.
The earlier you can book, if you know you're going, you can get a flight from the UK for like 500 quid.
Yeah, I went in January and MLK weekend, that was a tournament weekend, and I knew in advance I was going. I got my tickets for $120 round trip.
Yeah. When you know that you're going and you plan, if you make the commitment and say, right, I'm going,
yeah,
the cost is way, way down.
So, I mean, I had to sit on the wing, but I, you know, it was still only $120.
You weren't co-pilot.
Well, I think I had to serve the peanuts that you want. That's what it was.
Bloody hell, what are you drinking now?
Oh man, look at this. I got the small than you. This time.
Bigger well, yeah. than you.
Raspberry. It's a cider.
It's a sour.
Oh, sour. I thought
that was raspberry sour.
So a beer, yeah.
It is a beer. It's good too. Yeah. Cheers.
Cheers. Take your word for it.
Yeah. So, Martin, can we get one more song out of you?
Yeah, good. I'm going to do you a Liverpool Connection exclusive here.
All right.
Bill.
So, this is... Well,
then we should then we should ask for two songs. We should hear Fabinho's song first, and then the...
I haven't done one for Fabinho yet.
Or not Fabinho, Firmino, I'm sorry.
Oh, you... Si, Senor, as well.
Yeah.
We'll do that as well. So this one, it's been recorded. It should be out in the next week or two, actually. It's very, very close to being put out there. So I've done a song for Alison Becker.
Nice.
So very, very simply entitled, All We Need Is Alison Becker. So there's your clue where this is going.
He's going to be a good player for us, I guess.
He is, and it looks like he's going nowhere as well. It looks like looks like he's with us for the next 5 or 6 years anyway. So yeah, here's one for Alison Becker. We've seen the great European nights where Anfield glows under floodlight. Seen Etienne, it echoes on. The carping voice in unison. The keepers we've had through the years, great clamors lifted, oh big ears. Elisha Scott, Bruce Grobbelaar, we needed the next superstar. We called for you, you came from Rome. We bought you with the money from Coutinho. All we need is Alison Becker. He's our keeper, Alison Becker. All we need is Alison Becker. He's our keeper, nobody better. Alison is true. Alisson, who's top eyes, we love you.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Radio Gaga, which is bizarrely, that came from Jurgen Klopp. It was a press conference. He's like, all we need is Alison Becker. That's all he said. Yeah. So we've kind of picked up from that and developed a little song for him.
Ah, that's sound though.
Yeah. And I love his dancing. He's a good dancer too, right?
He's good. Well, he's great at a barbecue as well. Like, have you seen his barbecues on Instagram?
Mm-hmm.
He he cooks some serious meat. Like, it's like they're proper steaks. What he puts on his barbecue.
Brazilian boys like the steaks.
Yes,
they do.
Mm-hmm. I guess
that was great.
Yeah, brill. When's that? When are you going to be recording that?
Well, it's being recorded now. It's probably about 90% done. In the next couple of days, it will be finished, and then it's a case of piecing together the video. But I think the idea is probably I'm probably going to get it up and out there before the end of the season. Mm-hmm. So it might be a case, because obviously time's running away with us now because of all of the football fixtures. It'd probably be a case of getting the song out there before the video. But the video, I'm about to reach out to all LFC fans as well. So if anyone wants to be involved in the video,
yes,
you can.
Let us know.
So we're going to be doing almost like a Zoom call, I guess. Mm-hmm. The idea is, because obviously it's what's going on now. You know, you're seeing the fan reactions from like Sky Sports and, you know, whoever's broadcasting. They'll show up the fan reactions and it'd be like a Zoom call and there's like, I don't know, 9 or 12 of them on the screen at once. So the idea is to kind of do something similar and include all the Liverpool fans in the video as well.
No, great idea. Yeah, we'd definitely be down for that.
Yeah, no, I'll let you know when we're doing it. I'd say it's going to be in the next week or so because the track, as soon as the track's finished, I think it's a case of getting it out to distribution and getting it out there on all the platforms, and then it'll probably be addressed a video the week later.
Mm-hmm. You know that all our guests that we've had on, and you know, we've had authors and singers, and we always tell them that whatever we can do as a podcast to help get the word out, because we love Liverpool. That's why this podcast started. Yeah. You know, we love the city, and we love just bringing everybody around the world together into this club. So yeah, whatever we can do to help you out, we'll definitely do it.
Thanks so much, Stephen. Yep. That's, you know what, you just kind of hit the nail on the head of what KopConnect is as well. It's a whole idea. You know, it's we're a global community. I think it's just a case of bringing everyone together, which is what we're trying to do. And it's what you're trying to do as well with the podcast as well. Mm-hmm. You know, you're reaching out, you're putting this out there, and Reds all over the world can tune in and listen to it.
You know, one of the things is that we always say we're going to stay to an hour, but then we just get to talking because we love talking. I still have beer left, so I got to keep talking. But why don't you, you don't mind, bring us home to the end of our show with the Bobby song.
Oh, we'll do that.
What? Is that all right, Darren? Or
do what? Yeah, of course, another bloody song.
Yes. let's end the show with the Bobby song.
The more I stay on the podcast, the more I stay away from my kids and the missus.
And thanks again for coming on, Mark.
Yeah, cheers, great. Mark.
That's close enough. Go on, and we do the Bobby song, guy.
There's something that the cop wants you to know. The best in the world is Bobby Firmino. I know the nine. Give him the ball and his gun every time. Si, senor. Give the ball to Bobby and he will score. There's something that the cop wants you to know. The best in the world is Bobby Firmino. Number nine, give him the ball and it's gone every time. Si, senor, give the ball to Bobby and he will score. There's something that the club wants you to know. Best in the world is Bobby Firmino. Number nine, give him the ball and he's gone every time. Si, senor, give the ball to Bobby and he will score. One more time. There's something that the club wants you to know. The best in the world is Bobby Firmino. I'm number nine. Si, señor. Give the ball to Bobby and he will score.
Brilliant.
Yeah, Darren was hoping that you were going to go and do it for an hour like at Hotel Tia that day.